Hello, my name is Andrew Gerzso. I'm a coordinator of the Ulysses project, which is a project within the context of the Creative Europe initiative of the European Commission. And today, in the context of the Forum Vertigo, we will be talking about collaborative creation. But before getting into a short introduction, I would like to introduce the various participants in this roundtable. First of all, Ute Pinter from Graz in Austria. She's Secretary General at for the Impulse Festival and Academy. Andrea Agostini, who is a composer in Italy. Adriana Armaroli, who is the Artistic Coordinator for Divertimento in Milan. Andrea Cera, who is also Italian, is a composer and sound designer. And last but not least, Bernhard Lang, who's a composer from Austria. So today we will be making an intersection between two tendencies that we see today. One of them has to do with one of the things that will be raised during this roundtable is the question of exploring the notion of collaboration and going beyond perhaps the usual practices in collaboration onto perhaps maybe the extreme form where several artists sign at the same level a work, be it a musical work or another. So that's one tendency. And the other tendency is the use of online tools and methodologies. Now, as in other areas, COVID has accelerated certain tendencies. And so, obviously, COVID has accelerated the tendency for the use of online technologies and methodologies. But the question here is not only how we adapt to this, but what's going to remain once COVID is over? How will the this situation impact over the long term our practices, our use and practices of online tools and methodologies? And then, of course, the question here on the roundtable is how, on the one hand, the collaborative aspect and the online aspect, how do they interact? And so I think that we will see some examples that can give us some ideas about how all of this is shaping up. But before going on to the discussion and let's say short presentation of people in the panel, I would like to simply evoke a project which was done in the context of also a creative European project called Comedia. And it's a project that we did back in 2010 called Netrike. And this was a work, actually this work began with an informal discussion with Winfried Rietsch from the IEM in Austria, where we decided one day that we would like to do an interactive event between Paris and Graz. But of course we needed a real artistic project for this event. And so Christine Geig, who is a choreographer, and Bernhard Lang, who is with us today, composer, put together a work which was called Netrike. And it was actually an extension of a work that existed before by Catherine Geig called Vitrike, and featured a dancer in live interaction with audio and video loops. So the Netrike work expanded these concepts. And the point is that at each site, the performers interacted locally with themselves as well as with the remote performers. And certain ideas like difference and repetition, open and dynamic systems, responsibility, dominance, and randomness were some of the ideas explored in this work. So during the performance we had in IRCAM, we had Alban Richard, who was a choreographer, who was giving cues to Max Fossati, the dancer. And in Austria, we had Christine Geig, who's a choreographer, giving cues to the dancer Véronique Azot. So this is a live performance between Paris and Graz, and so it was a collaborative effort between not only the artists but the technical teams, because there were quite a few challenges. And one of the things that was important was that the audience should come away with a feeling that they were in one common virtual room between Paris and Graz. So this is an important aspect. And so we had live specialized audio We were doing 3D ambisonics over the net, and there was also live a video as well. And in terms of the methodology, one of the things that was important in the work was we adopted what we called the reality principle, which was the ability to prove to the audience that what was going on was not a fake. Because you can, of course, show a film and say that this is coming live from someplace, but it could be totally faked. Somebody could just be sitting in the next room with a computer pressing on a button. So what was important was that each audience see each other, and we even went so far as importing the noise that audience makes when they're on their chairs, moving feet and stuff like that. Of course, when we're in a concert, we find this irritable, but this is associated, these are sort of cues that come with the performance, and this way we know that the audience is really there. So I would like to show you two brief excerpts of the film from the performance that we did. So the first film is to give you an idea of the setup. So Eric, if I could have the first excerpt of the video film. No, that's the slide. What I want is the film. Oh, here we go. Okay. So that's me presenting the work in Paris. Maybe you can put the play button just to give it a little. Okay.
Okay. Good evening. And,
okay, you can cut off this guy who's talking
a little bit. My name is Andrew Gerzso. And with my
the whole point of showing you this was to show you the setup. So over to the left, you see the video of the audience. And so that's the audience in Graz.
Okay.
And of course, the people in Graz had the video of the people in Paris. And the screen on the right was the screen dedicated to the artistic activity because we have interaction going on, video interaction, sound loop interaction going on between Paris and Graz. And there's some just right behind me talking there on the floor. You can see a rectangular space, which was a metal plate which was used to create sounds which were spatialized and sent to both halls. So you can now put maybe the second excerpt. This will give you an idea of the performance. So we said, what did we say around? Okay, so here we see on the image, there we go. So we have the dancer moving on the metal plate, creating sounds, and at the same time we have another dancer at the other area also moving on a metal plate. But the video loops and sound loops are mixed together in an interactive fashion. Okay, so this is an important aspect of the work. So maybe we can show the slide now that was there before. You can stop this. Okay, and so you see these are on the left hand side, you see the setup in Paris, where you have the metal plaque, this is a yellow thing in the middle, and then the two screens on the left, one for the audience, and on the right, one for the artistic events, capturing the dancers. And in Graz and in Paris, it's exactly the same thing. So the two sites are symmetrical, and the idea was that this symmetricality, so to speak, could contribute to the understanding of the work and being, again, also convinced that what was going on was really going on and that it was not faked. Okay, so this is a project that we did almost 10 years ago, which was quite experimental, where we learned a certain number of things. And then, without going so much into the artistic aspects, I would just like to say quickly to finish up. This was a big technical challenge, but we had the support of the Renater Research Network, and so we had a very good connection. And so, in actual fact, getting back and forth 16 channels of sound, 4 channels of video was not a problem, which we all were wary of. But then, one of the things we learned, amongst others, was that managing a work in terms of the rehearsals and the performance on a two-site rehearsal, on a two-site basis, presented a certain number of challenges. So this, very quickly, is just an example of a work that was done in the past. that has fed some projects in the future. Now, in the context of this performance, there was a work done by Andrea Cera called Zoom Up, and he will talk about that when he comes to, when it will come to Andrea's turn to give us an idea of his perspective on the two notions of collaboration and online tools that we've been discussing up to now. Okay, so I would like to move on to maybe begin with a first presentation by Ute Pinter. And Ute is going to give us a sort of a general perspective in terms of some general considerations, some examples of collaborative projects that she has worked on, that she has put together. And so the collaboratory aspect is something which has been quite present in the activities of Impulse for the past year. So, Ute, could you please give us your perspective on this?
Hello to everyone, and thanks to Andrew for the introduction and having me here. As Andrew already mentioned, I'm going to give some examples of collaborative projects of Impulse in the past, and also projects that are developed right now for the sake of the Ulysses Network. But let me just start out with some general thoughts around the topic of collaboration. I would think that in times of globalization, with globally prevailing, not to say globally shared problems, be it the current pandemic, ecological troubles, economical constraints, the need for cooperation is called for maybe more than ever before, and actually might turn into a question of survival in the end. Consequently, one might state that the issue of collaboration, also in the artistic fields, could convey an important social and political dimension connecting to current topics such as inclusion, non-hierarchical structures, open source and shared knowledge, networking, redefinition of traditional roles, sharing economy and means of production, altogether offering alternative strategies to the predominant prevailing conditions. Trying to define collaboration, we might consider categories and aspects such as permanent teams and collective, as we know them from the fine arts quite often, Gilbert and George being one of the examples, but also from music with working bands in jazz, or longtime collaborators like Fellini and Nino Rota, writing his film music, or more or less loose collectives, the Groupe de Six being one of them, though the actual collaboration was just happening in a few occasions. And there's also the aspect of collaboration of various disciplines as a central constituent point for an institution such as the Bauhaus, or in the context of Gesamtkunstwerk, versus, on the other hand, collaboration for a specific project only. So when we think of collaboration in music, we might also consider aspects such as music as just one component in a larger whole, such as it is the case with opera productions, music theater, ballet, film, musical, etc., or the collaboration of composers with sound directors, programmers, technicians in productions with live electronics, etc. The collaboration in the context of scientific research projects in industry, in advertisement, or it might also lead us to discuss the meaning of collaboration in the field of, for example, instant composition or free improvisation, where musicians are performers and authors at the same time, leading toward shared authorship within the groups. Or in the field of concept music, conceptual pieces, graphic and text notation, where the interpreter develops into a more active, more often also decision-making partner of the composer, thus leading towards some sort of co-authorship, especially when we think of personalities such as David Tudor, who even worked out and noted a performance course. We might even consider special cases such as remixes or arrangements as sort of detached collaborations, or consider the role of the audience not only as receiver, which by itself is already an active constituting part in any form of communication, but which in interactive works is per se an essential non-neglectable part for the realization of the work itself. Not to forget, of course, music as uniting collaborative group experience in rituals or tribal practices, or most current examples of collective writing and collective compositions, such is the case in a new thing that we're being introduced within shortly, or an Austrian initiative by Michael Diefenbacher and Tobias Vedo Valley during COVID-19 with the project On Cue with shared composition. Now, these examples of collaboration aspects lead us directly to connected topics such as authorship, and hereby again, the relevance of authorship in concern of royalties, money, career, making a name for oneself, or developing a brand beyond one's own name. The roles and status of, for example, composer and interpreter, ranging from the interpreter as the composer's servant, so to say, up to the unknown composer of, for example, world famous hits such as Strangers in the Night, that is related to Frank Sinatra rather than to its German composer, Bert Kempfert. It leads us also to topics such as conditions and means of production, with, on the one hand, division of labor amongst numerous experts working together for production in well-financed institutions versus low-budget conditions that either call for collaboration for a very different reason or call for model, performer, composer, technician, stage manager, artist as a one man or woman show, on the other hand, even though this might, of course, also be questioned. Be a question of deliberate decision, artistic independency, multi-talents, total control, mania, etc. Or it may touch the question of hierarchical structures as maintenance of power versus flat hierarchies, related also to factors such as final responsibilities, decision-making, control, group dynamics, etc. It may also touch the idea of collaboration as method of inclusion, be it of amateurs, fringe groups, the audience, etc., or touch aspects of the special quality of long-time collaborations versus the freshness or risks of new encounters, or the role technical development plays in opening up possibilities for collaboration, especially in times of corona, such as improved latency, avoiding technology for online rehearsals and performances, as developed also by the Institute of Electronic Music in Graz at the moment. So as to Impulse and the project that ran through Ulysses in concern of Collaboratory, partly at least, Impulse in its first outcome is an academy with an associate festival, and just like universities, of course, offers different and other possibilities and conditions than the market and music business, for example, does. Even though hopefully a helpful stop and step in the artist's development and also in their careers, Impulse as an academy is at least ostensibly more about exchange, experimentation, getting expertise, being a platform for mutual learning and development, thus being a sort of collaborative laboratory by itself. One of the central aims of Impulse from the very beginning back in the 90s was like the intense cooperation and collaboration of musicians and composers, have them work together, make them share experiences and knowledge, and being a sort of academic playground for them, not being occupied that much and primarily about authorship. For quite some years now, several special workshops have hereby provided a platform for non-hierarchic experimentation, exchange, and also co-writing. Examples hereby include workshops with an intense cooperation of musicians and composers, One being, for example, the Special for Composers and Accordionists, coached by Rebecca Saunders and Krasimir Sterev, with the exploration and investigation of the specific instrument, calling for an active collaboration and close communication in between composer and musician, and developing new pieces and works together. All of them with exercises and focus on, for example, very specific sound palettes or specific aspects and features of the accordion, also as an object. Another example would be Michael Meyerhof and Christian Dierstein's extended percussion composition workshop that investigated 21st century percussion, both from the musicians and the composer sides, interrogating new ideas and aspects of sound, constructing partly new self-made instruments and developing new technical skills together. All of that following the fact that contemporary music often calls on the skills and inventiveness of percussionists when it comes to translating new ideas of sounds or performative actions in new composition. Another area of collaboration was also touched in workshops the topic of instant composition and development of improvisational concepts in mixed groups of composers and musicians, as coached by Manon Leo Winter or Frank Radkowski or Reinhard Friedl, as well as the realization of concept pieces and graphically notated pieces, leading to some sort, at least, of co-authorship. And there was, of course, a couple of collaboratory projects in an even more concrete sense through, for example, interdisciplinary projects, such as Text im Klang, that saw its fourth edition last year, coming along with commissions, both for composers and authors, and a 1 to 2 year preparation phase, several meetings of everyone involved in the program, the authors, the composers, the interpreters, analyzing, for example, their specific working methods, leading discussions on possible approaches to text in music, identifying an overall topic as guiding element for the new texts and compositions, and last but not least, developing also an overall dramaturgy for the final event. Workshop that actively go for an interdisciplinary approach were also set up by composers like Peter Ablinger with his Composition Beyond Music project, or Simon Steen Andersen and Simon Löffler with Music Extended, calling for the inclusion of artists from other disciplines, or at least interdisciplinary elements in the composers or the artist's work. Or to give a more concrete example in the end, the special program by name Collaboratory with Stefan Prinz that we set up in 2017 the first time, that then saw another edition in Darmstadt in 2018, and that should have come back to Impulse now in February, but needs to be delayed to maybe 2023 due to Corona. Now, the intention and methodology of Stefan Prinz's Collaboratory is mainly based on experimentation on spot, dialogue and feedback by the whole group, plus one-to-one sessions with him as a coach to develop own works in progress over a time span of 12 days. Therefore, collaboration is asked in this workshop in various ways, such as by sharing space, infrastructure, equipment, thoughts, energy, inspiration, and by also perceiving collaboration in its social and political dimensions. By sharing ideas and finding collaborators for further development and the realization of the projects evolving, and by, for example, daily obligatory group meetings for exchange of experience, checking on the status quo of works evolving and getting feedback and input from the coach and the colleagues, and working towards a final presentation with a jointly developed dramaturgy and coherent overall concept where each participant is part of a larger whole, also participating in the works of colleagues hereby. As to the applications we receive for workshops such as Collaboratory, which include, for example, letters of motivation, examples of relating works done already, and descriptions of ideas for a project, one quite frequently finds keywords such as expectations of merging creativity, sharing ideas and knowledge, profit from diverse backgrounds, views and personalities, witness the processes and having the chance for experimentation. The same holds true for the willingness to open up to one's concept, to the ideas and abilities colleagues bring in, to start out with a very general concept that allows development within the group and allows adaptations, or work with text scores that can then lead to different results depending on the approach for the realization by the performers. And there's also a tendency towards creations of intermediate works, installations, inclusion of performative elements, text scores, and hereby getting away from classical stage settings. As to the big online topic, Impulse has not really made any experience on a broader level, but for example, preparations of workshops partly start also online with bringing interpreters and composers together before they actually arrive on spot, or getting some expertise already by the tutors, composition tutors, for preparing compositions to be then worked out during impulse. Well, I hope this short introduction could give an idea about general considerations on this topic of collaboration and collaborative settings, and some more inside information in specific examples and projects Impulse holds at the moment. For the website, I can give you the hint to, for example, visit also the archives at www.impulse.cc. So, and happy to answer questions if there's any.
That was very rich and raised a lot of different types of activities and questions. But right now I'd like to move on to Andrea Agostini. We will come back during the discussion session at the end. I have already some questions on Ute's presentation. We move on to a presentation by Andrea Agostini, who is a composer, and he will talk to us about a collective group which has been put together. So please, Andrea, it's now your turn.
Hello. Thank you for being here, and thank you for the invitation. I think I represent here a sort of a case study, in that I'm actually a part of a member of a group of composers based mostly in Italy called New Thing. And I would like to review shortly and share with you a few both biographical and perhaps more technical and motivational details behind our activity. So I would start with a little bit of history. So who we are and where did we start? We are, as I was saying, a group of Italian composers. And at the very beginning, there was a private mailing list. So we happened to exchange messages about music we were hearing, about things we would like to talk about the context, both aesthetical and political of contemporary music, especially, but not only in Italy. By the way, we all are composers with some rich activity in France, especially, but let's say, on a rather international ground, and we all studied at IRCAM at different times in our lives and cooperated with IRCAM. So we had at least this basic, let's say, biographical facts in common. We are all relatively close by age, being all born between, let's say, the mid-1970s to the mid-1980s. So we represent, let's say, a rather coherent age group. And we started exchanging emails just randomly among a group of friends. And here I have been quite struck by the introduction by Frank Madlener when he said, maybe the real network is friendship. Now, this is especially and exactly my case here. So we started off because we were friends. And at some point, someone in the mailing list said, okay, but maybe what we're saying here is not just of our private interest, but it might be relevant for someone else too. So we might make this exchange public. And we decided to start a blog. The spark came from an intervention on someone else's blog, Renato Rivolta, who wrote on his blog about contemporary music, an intervention, a rather interesting one, whose title was Contemporary Music is Dead. And that sparked the idea of writing about why perhaps contemporary music was not dead, and the experience of a group of persons actually doing and making their own life out of it. We were all friends and we were all composers. The blog went on for a while. By the way, I would like to share with you not a slide, actually, but a page of the blog, which I think is pretty representative of the kind of things we were doing at the time. The blog is either dead or dormant now, I'm not sure. But I would like to share it with you still. The blog is dormant, but the collective is quite alive, as we will see. So this is a quite typical page of the blog. There are texts written by ourselves. They were all signed. Okay, so it was not an experiment in collective writing, but in collective discussion at this point. There were posts by friends, other artists, Mariangela Vacatello, an amazing pianist, Italian pianist, Giovanni Verrando, a great composer, something more political, something more aesthetical, like this. I'm sorry, it's all in Italian, but it's just to give you a hint. Again, a post by a friend, announcement, and so on. Okay, so it was very much a sort of mishmash of different themes and subjects connected to the real life of contemporary music in Italy and in Europe. And this is us. Actually, for the first years of the blog, we were six. There was Marco Momi, an amazing Italian composer, with us. And then for various reasons, he chose to quit the group. And now we are, well, it's not sure if we are four or five, but I prefer to think that we are five. And this is the five of us. So that's me, and these are my friends and colleagues. We started writing about music, and there was a lot of talk, intermittent talk about, well, maybe at some point we should try to write some music together. And there was no real reason behind that, except perhaps, well, the sheer joy, I would say, of doing things together, whereas we all were coming from a context in which the activity is very much solitary. So we all, as composers, are trained to work on our own. There is a great potential in that, of course. We are completely responsible and free to express our egos and individualities. But on the other hand, we kind of had some envy for artistic practices, like, for example, popular music, in which it is customary and normal that the creative activity is a collective activity. So this was just one of the sparks pushing us to consider actually writing music together. And I have to say, I think that another spark, which was a very important one for us, was the idea that every one of us could learn things from the others. Because after all, we were all in a, let's say, established phase of our career as composers. So our studies were over and had been over since years. And of course, we all go on with studying every day, all day. It's one of the things we do all the time. But at the same time, the idea itself of learning from watching someone else is something that is really alien to our current practice today. And that was the occasion, because of course, every one of us has his own practices, his own tools, his own abilities, and perhaps his own deficiencies. So the idea of everyone learning by seeing what the others were doing upon a common project was something very strong at the time. And at some point the occasion came. The artistic director of Milano Musica, the Italian festival, called us and proposed us to work on a collective piece together. And we jumped on board immediately, and we actually did it. It was a long work, and I need to talk a little bit, so I will spend some words about how we actually worked. And we composed a rather long and massive piece for ensemble and electronics. It's a 40-minute work called I Mille Fuochi dell'Universo, so the thousand... Well, we never agreed whether we should translate fuochi as fires, so perhaps the stars, or foci, so the geometrical, the geometrical turning points of the universe. I don't know. No, I didn't want to do this. I just wanted to share with you the the YouTube page where you can see the piece. We're not going to hear, not even an excerpt now. I don't think it's interesting within this context, but if you're curious, please feel free to search for this on YouTube and you will find the recording. Okay, so it was quite a big production, and it was a very interesting one in that we really could do what we were hoping we would have done. So learning from each other and working together, I would say in a horizontal way rather than a vertical one. What do I mean by this? This, I would say, is perhaps and was our only rule in that. I want to move on a little bit with history because this was happening in 2017 and there is a bit of history from that on. Now, from that point, we stopped writing on the blog, actually. As I was telling you, it's at the very least dormant now. So we stopped writing on the blog for a few reasons, I think. One is that we're not musicologists. And at some point, it became clear that we did not have, how can I say, the horsepower, I might say, to keep on with what was increasingly becoming a sort of critical and musicological task. And that was not our job. And we were lacking the context, the philosophy, the words. So that was a very, something that kept like buzzing in my mind is, okay, I had two or three things I wanted to say about contemporary music, and I said them. And that was it, basically. So the texts are still there. But I didn't want to keep on repeating my two or three main points and tenets at the time. And so there was no point in keeping on. And another point, which was perhaps marginal, but it was apparently marginal, but it was not, is that we didn't feel, well, there was a strong response to the blog at the beginning in the Italian contemporary music world. And we made the choice at the beginning of writing in Italian. Although I think we are all relatively fluent in at least English and French. But the choice of writing in Italian was that we cared a lot about some sort of literary quality of the text we were writing. And the fact of being able, I speak for myself here, but I think I can speak for everyone else. The fact of being able to sustain a technical or anecdotal conversation in English or in French doesn't allow me to write in literary English and French with a level of writing quality we really cared about. And that was one strong reason that kept us from broadening the scope of the project to a larger audience. And eventually this sort of pigeonholed us and kind of forced us to make the difficult choice to whether lower the quality of the intervention or stop writing. And at that point we took the choice to stop writing, at least for the time. We received a lot of complaints for that, but we never had the spark of moving on and keep writing words again from that. But what we did is that we started working on a number of other activities. And I think two are important to mention here. One is that we started working to a new production. It is something that is still a bit like industrial secret, so I can't reveal a lot about that, but it's going to be a work for solo electronics. And it's going to be a rather large scale one. So it is something that we hope will see the light perhaps in the next month or year. And it's a very experimental one in a way. And the other thing we have started doing from that point on was a sort of pedagogical activity. And I think that Adriana Armaroli from the Divertimento Ensemble will have more words about that. Perhaps, I don't know if we were planning to talk about this, but a part of this is very recent actually, and we will act as mentors for another collective of younger composers let's say, guide their collective compositional activity and hopefully try to help them avoid the pitfalls which we encountered during our own work. So that's it now. I think, I don't know how much time I have left, a few minutes more, I think.
Sorry? 2 minutes.
Yeah, okay, perfect. So I think it's interesting if I just tell you a little bit about the compositional project and process. So we didn't have any very strict rules in a way, except that what we wanted to avoid was the collection of short pieces. Of course, that was something very easy to do. So working in a vertical way, as we were saying. Okay, so we didn't want to do this. We didn't want our collective work to be the collage of shorter moments. So we really tried to find ways, and then, okay, this can be discussed technically, but I don't think it's the time now for that. But we really tried to find way to be all working on the same temporal extent of music at the same time. And this is involved the improvisation, this involved collective brainstorming, this involved inventing tools, so a lot of sharing on Dropbox, all the fact that we were all working on the same software platforms, exchanging files all the time. We all bought a professional Dropbox account for exchanging data all the time, constantly, and so on. So that was very important. I would say it was the only strict ethical tenet we had. Besides the fact that we all were fully accountable for everything that the collective was doing. So, I mean, of course, at the end of the day, there are parts of the work we've written together that are more responsibility, more under the responsibility of one or another of us. But let's say the signature is collective, and I might say you will never know who wrote what, except that perhaps if you know our individual styles, you might be able to spot some, I don't know, some earworms here and there, just suggesting who did what. But that's very local, and I would like to think that maybe there are also false friends in this sense. Maybe not everything belongs to the person it appears to belong to. Okay, and I would like to quote, if I have 30 more seconds, one specific example of how this collective compositional work happened. Of course, every one of us has some specialties, let's say. We all have things that belong more to our everyday practice. And at some point, it became clear to some of us that there was some part of work that had to be done to some other one. So, for example, I might be saying to someone else, hey, you should write this section with this technique that belongs to you. And that was very interesting in a way, because it was a sort of relinquishing of creativity in terms of an idea whose ownership was becoming completely fluid at that point and completely fluid. I don't know which other word to find. So at the moment in which person A was asking to person B, write something with your own tool but following this idea, this was the very moment, I think, in which the collective magic was taking place in a way. Okay, so the fact that someone was able to recognize that someone else had more skills than himself for doing one specific part of the work. Of course, everything was much more complex than this, but I think that was a very important and interesting point. So this was just to give you a short idea. There would be much more that I might want to add, but I think my time is over now, and I hope that I give you a sort of overview of the challenges and the difficulties, and at some point, at the same time, the richness of this kind of work. So thank you for listening, and of course, if there are questions, I'm here.
Okay, Andrea, thank you very much. That was, like Ute, that was very rich. I've noted some questions. I hope also that on the panel members, you are noting questions that you will ask each other when we reach towards the end of this process of presentation. I would like now to move on to a presentation by Adriana Armaroli, who is going to speak not only about her experience of putting stuff online, some projects online, but also specifically about a project which is involved in the Collaboratory project, which is part one of the sub-projects in the Ulysses project. Collaboratory in the sense of laboratory of collaboration. So that's why we called it Collaboratory. So Adriana, please, if you could give us your perspective.
Yes, hello, thank you, Andrew, and hello to everyone. Yes, as you said, I will go back to the last words of Andrea Agostini at the end of my intervention, because I would like to divide it in two parts. And that is the first part dedicated to Divertimento Ensemble's online activities, and the second part regarding the Collaboratory project, a project of collective composition, which has been conceived and is being done together with the collective New Thing. As Andrea, I would like to begin with some history, but very shortly. Just to say that we had a first period last year when the lockdown began, when after the first shock, as everyone, when we all saw our concert halls closed suddenly and had to renounce to our concerts. After the first moment of shock, we decided not to stop and to react immediately to this situation. And so we rescheduled our concert season named Rondò, and it became Rondò a distanza, at a distance. And so we tried to keep the contact to the audience and also with the academy, to the students, and in general with music, and also going on giving a work to our musicians, because it was also very important and very social. And so we went on a little bit improvising and deciding very soon what to do. I will be sharing my screen from time to time. I'm doing it now, just to show you a schedule. Okay, can you see my screen?
Yes.
Okay. So this is just to show you how my intervention will be organized and what about I will be talking. During this first period, we decided not to stop with concerts, and we also decided to invent a new project. This is Io Resto a Casa, I Stay at Home. This was a call for performers, and this was totally new, and it was successful. We were very happy with that, because it was a call for performers, very young ones, under 30, and we asked for home concerts recorded at home with very simple means, because nobody was technologically had no technological means at the moment, because we had no time to provide the means, and we received very beautiful concerts. We had 82 applications, and we published 52 videos. And also after we published all the videos, we voted, the ensemble voted, and also the audiences, our audience, and we selected 10 winners. And these 10 winners were invited to come to the current Rondò season. And so it was a sort of prize, and it was also an immediate way to find out something new and created for the online transmission and online gatherings. And I am showing you some pictures. This is the cover of our new Rondò 2020, Appuntamenti a distanza, because we had to abandon our original Rondò. We tried to keep the dates, and we organized concerts on Zoom. This was a way also to meet our audience again, because they were really meetings where we chatted a little bit with the audience, where the audience could ask questions, and it was very social, very warm. It was a good solution not to be separate from the audiences and the musicians. And the concerts were very often recorded at home. For instance, this singer and another singer here. This is another singer singing from her lake. And this was interesting because everyone invented something new to record his, her concerts. And so we were quite happy of this solution. Besides the concerts and the project I Stay at Home, which was a call, we had other activities. This was I Stay at Home and I Play for You, the call. Then, okay, these two. This was the description of the call. But I don't want to be too long. Anyway, 82 applications and 52 videos. It was quite important for us. And the audience reacted very actively, voting, and there were discussions, and it was really interesting. Then other activities that we brought online were this laboratory workshop of musical listening of today's music. It was live before. It was people gathered in a hall, and they discussed and listened to music, and it was brought online. And this was very important because it worked a lot, and so we have decided this year to keep it online. And so keeping it online, we are reaching many more people, and people not just from Milano, but also from Sicily and other regions, from Italy. And so this was a good idea to extend it and to decide to maintain it online. Then another interesting experiment was the recording of a piece by Donatoni, Flan. This was an Italian premiere, and we decided to do it. It was, everything happened in spring 2020. The ensemble was not used, not to meet and not to play together and rehearse and do concerts. And so we decided to play, not together, but everyone at home, but then bringing all the recordings together as everyone did in that period. Maybe you will remember that during the lockdown, all choirs, ensembles, orchestras uploaded performances which derived from the assembly of individual recordings on the web. Everyone got a lot of them by WhatsApp and so on. And so we decided to do that. It was a way to be musically and spiritually together again. It was important and had also a symbolic meaning, being this the first activity carried out by the ensemble after some weeks without meeting. And being that a piece by Donatoni, who was our directors and conductors teacher. and also an Italian premiere. So then we did some educational activities. This is a workshop for composers. The composers are online on the screen. And also the final concerts of the workshop with the composers on the screen attending the concert. And so this was the first part of our activity. Okay, here I am again, okay. And after the summer, we began with the second period, the second phase of our online activities. And this is quite different from the first one because we now produce events that are created online with the, not suddenly, but with appropriate technical means and also with new artistic formats, which are different from the live ones. We have created a virtual stage. This is a web TV and with the special contents and formats that will continue also later when the theaters will reopen. And this means that we have now, so to say, a dual programming, live and online. And from now on, this will always be so. So we have increased our activity. And also the online platform can host the activities that must be, that should be canceled because they cannot be realized in the theaters. But we have a sort of parachute with the online, with the web TV. I am sharing again the screen. Can you see it? Not yet?
Yes.
Okay. I would like to go on our television, web TV, just very quickly start watching what it is and what the content is. This is a web TV entirely dedicated to today's music, to the languages of it. It has a schedule with a program of concerts. It's a bit slow, okay. This is the highlight of today, a project called the Young Performers on Digital Stage. But then we have concerts, we are implementing the web TV now, so they are concerts recently recorded, but it will have also old concerts that we decided to share with everyone. Individual pieces, so single pieces that we share as an online archive. Then meeting new music. This is the protagonists of the music of today. Discussed and are discussed in a series of encounters, debates, lectio magistralis, appraisals. This is for the audience to discover the evolution of contemporary music. Then we have Young Performers on Digital Stage. This is a new project I'm going to talk about. And then the collection. We are putting together some contents about the same theme, the same topic, the same composer, and so on, just to suggest how people can see and watch videos and listen to contents on the same topic, and many, many collections. And so we are implementing it, and it will be richer and richer with the time. The project, the newest project, is this one, Young Performers on Digital Stage. And this is really new because it started yesterday. We will present, we made a call dedicated to young composers, and we got a lot of very interesting concerts. It was a call for a concert produced for this project, dedicated to the project by young performers from all over Europe. And we got really a lot of high quality concerts. We are also happy because we asked for compositions also by women composers, and we got about half of the compositions written by women composers, and also about half of the performers are women. And so we think we will offer 16 very beautiful concerts. They will be transmitted every Tuesday from yesterday to June. And also on this occasion, like it was with I Stay at Home, the ensembles, the members of the Divertimento Ensemble and the audience will then choose the best ones who will be invited to play in our next season in 22, and also to form an ensemble to be invited to Milan in 2022.
Adriana, we're running out of time here. Could you... maybe, let's put it this way. You have 5 minutes maximum left.
Ah, okay, yes. So I'm going a little bit quicker. So this was the TV. This was young performers on digital stage. These are a couple of pictures taken from the young composers on digital stage again. And this is our pianist introducing the concert, because every concert will be introduced by a member of the Divertimento Ensemble. Then we go to other projects, especially thought for online. And these are Rado musical drama. We have commissioned two musical pieces conceived specifically for the web to Alessandro Solbiati and to Edoardo Dadone. These projects will be recorded and then presented on our web TV. They are not thought to be presented on a stage. They will be also transmitted by the National Italia Radio. And so they were thought in occasion of invention of new projects for online. And in our vision, this should open up new dimensions of creativity for the composers. And then another project is the radio, the Rondò Smart Festival. This will be a weekend with about 50 events dedicated to nowadays music. It will have a schedule of events lasting from 30 minutes to 1 hour. And all these events will continue without interruption, and they will remain available online in the following days. So to say, we want to offer 2 days of contemporary music with a full calendar, alternating between musical performances, debates, explanations, reflection, and so on. This will be on the web TV, which is usually a pay TV, but very, very cheap. But on this occasion of this festival, will be free. And then the last, but not least, project is Merge Up, the collective composition project that was introduced by Andrea Agostini. This was a suggestion given by the Ulysses Network, and this was something we did not thought about in the past, but we decided it was a very interesting suggestion. And also our artistic director, Sandro Gorli, said, we take the project because this will change the panorama, so to say, of the composers. And it will go out of the limits of the usual working conditions of composers. And from this point of view, it goes in the same direction of other projects of the Divertimento Ensemble, when we when we decided to offer to composers new frames, working with the children, non-musician children, or to work with the choir of non-musicians, adults. So this is a suggestion not to look to, within themselves to the composers, but to look for answers in other persons. And so we made this call. The name is Emerge Up, for composers not older than 35. We got 32 applications. Among them, only 14 from Italy, the other ones from all over Europe. And many projects were of musical theater, and only just four or five of pure music. And one of these projects was selected. The selection was made by Divertimento Ensemble and the collective New Thing, as Andrea Agostini said before. A collective one, a very young one, for the occasion composed. They are an Italian and a French and a Swiss composers. Originally, the project was conceived to be live, to be face-to-face. But then, when the lockdown began, we decided to change it and to reconceive it from the beginning and to make it just online. Of course, it will be... Yes?
Adriana, we have to move on here.
Okay, so okay. But it was the last project, and I think maybe we can say something more with Andrea during the discussion.
Okay, we can come back to that.
Yes. So that was all. It was
okay. Sorry,
the last project.
I'm sorry to rush you.
Sorry for being too long. There were many things.
That's okay. Okay. So since we're a little bit pressed for time here, Andrea, I would like to Andrea Cera. We have many Andrea, Andrew, Andreas today. Andrea Cera, if you could talk to us about your perspective as a composer and your experience, in particular, but also as a sound designer.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Andrew. Thank you, IRCAM, for the invitation. I hope I won't be too boring because I'm going to speak a little bit more on technical parts. I will talk about four works, two in the past, two in the present. And my main idea is that when working in disconnected places using networks at distance, you have to, you know, explode a project or the work and the relation between all the collaborators, take some fragments, put them together in some kind of separated in space and time, and then let the public do the synthesis, all right? So this would be the fil rouge of these four projects that I'm going to show you. Let me share my screen and... Zach, do you see it?
Yes.
Cool. So, first project, we go back to 2009, and this is a project that we did with IRCAM and the University of Genova, their infamous department led by Professor Antonio Camurri, where we created a room, a kind of room that linked together two places, one in Genova and one in Hamburg. Oops, sorry, I lost my... Okay, Genova and Hamburg. And inside these two rooms, you have a person in each room, and the person will interact with the other person online through a kind of strange avatar, where half person is the local user, is the real image of the local user, and the other is a kind of blob representing the movement, the quantity of movement, the quality of movement of your partner online. So basically, you are playing with another person. You are trying to create some kind of resonance with that person. And the soundscape will change according to the quality of this interaction. So if you are like dancing, you will hear some kind of technoid, dancey music. And if you're very calm and sweet, you will hear some kind of drone ambient music. I think that the interesting thing is that here we exchanged very simple things. No image, no sound, but just a very simple reduction of image. We call it half blob. It's a very simplified image. The quantity of motion of people, presence of someone online, yes, not, is a very simple data, and the calculation of resonance. If these two entities are resonating together, okay? And then there was also a snapshot at the end of the experience. You could see a snapshot of your partner. So very simple data, not complex data, not video, beautiful video or sounds, etc. Just simple data. And this lack of complexity, this very simple representation, is for me the engine that makes the interaction extremely exciting between people. Okay. Second work. This is the zoom up performance that Andrew was talking about. So this is a concert between Paris and the IEM Institute in Graz, where you have two performers, two piano players. This is the scene in Paris. So there is the French piano player. And he is live on scene, but we also see a live stream of him, and then we see the live stream of the other pianist in Graz. Here again, what we exchange is very simple. It's not sound, it's not music, it is just MIDI data. And MIDI data is just a very poor representation of what the musician is doing, just which key of the keyboard he's pressing, basically, right? Since we had also cameras, we also exchanged a notion of quantity of movement of each performer. So basically, how much they were moving, you know? Okay, so in each space, we had the Max MSP space who synthesized the sound. So basically, both performers were playing one locally and the other remotely the same Max MSP patch. And the transmission of MIDI data is extremely simple, extremely quick. So the two performers were really in real time. It was like they were playing in the same room. Then there was also a transmission of image, of the real image, as you see here, of course. And so in the transmission of image, there was a little bit of latency, of course. But as you know, the auditory system and the visual system have different time scale. So you maybe see a little bit of latency in the image, but it was almost non-existent, I think. Okay, third project. So before, here again, very simplified communication of data. Not huge streams of sound and image, very simple, very poor in a way, lacking of something, but this lacking of something is the secret why you have the sensation of, as a public, as a viewer, to putting together something. And again, I think the sensation of this work was really of something live and living. Okay. Third situation is a situation from now. It's a project that I am working on with IRCAM and a collective of artists from Taiwan who are called Luxury Logical. So Luxury Logico, they build robotic installations made with architectural machines, electric motors. In our case, they are building light modules who fly in space moved by steel cables. I take care of the sound design of those objects, and I also write a little bit of brightness of these light modules, while IRCAM takes care of a very important part, which is the spatialization of sounds. And we are lucky to have Thomas Goffer with us to do that. So there is this space where you see two light modules moving in space. and we are surrounded by sound, and all the spatialization is made by Thomas. And here we can see some examples. So this is IRCAM space. So there is a kind of simplified wave field synthesis situation plus other specialized loudspeakers. So they take care of the really the special dimension of the sound. And we have to do this. Zack. And this is the space in Taiwan, where here you can maybe see these are the light modules. I don't know if it's clear. These are the objects who move in space in the dark. Now they took a photo with light, of course. And they also have a simplified sound structure, I think with 5 or 7 channels, I don't remember. And here is how we interact. So basically, this is videos from Taiwan where we see the lights moving the way they program it. Here we can do a simulation using their movement data. And here we can see a simulation of the sound sources. All right. And that's interesting in this case because of the kind of data that we share. We have three kinds of data, essential data, which are data without which it would be impossible to work. So the movement that Taiwan designed of their moving lights, the coordinates in time, my multi-channel renderings that everybody has to use in order to work, my writing of LED data, which is, of course, okay, and these are really essential things that we exchange. Then we have support data, which are kind of simulations or rendering simplification of the red data, which are essential to understand what's going on, because otherwise everything would be too complex to work. So we need some kind of support data to understand each other. And finally, documentation data, which are recordings that try to be as faithful as possible about the real final outcome. So for instance, Thomas at IRCAM is making recordings with artificial head in order to have me listening to the multi-channel soundscape, which is very complex to reproduce for a stereo listening. And from Taiwan, they send us several generations of video recordings with different time of exposure in order to see either the movement of the lights or the details of the programming of LEDs. So, you know, this is another form of fragmentation, is a fragmentation of hierarchy of data and also, I think, of temporal use of that, because the red data are the first who arrive, then the green, and finally the blue ones. And that's an interesting concept that could be also be used for some more artistic, I mean, this is a really practical idea, but could be more artistically exploited. Do you have time for the last project, Andrew?
Very quickly, you have 2 minutes, okay. 3 minutes okay. at the most.
So last project, how to tune the sounds of a car in France while sitting in my studio in Italy. So I live here near Venice. I work with Renault, which is a maker of cars, and I do sounds for them. And sometimes during the before COVID era, I had to go to Paris or X to tune some of the sounds. You know, you go in the car, you listen, you understand resonances, and you filter out stuff, stuff like this. This time is not possible. So what I'm going to do, what we are doing is that we devised a system with 2 channels of data communication, one in real time. So I ask my colleagues in France to drive the car in a certain way, and they send me back the sound that they have. So we can, in real time, have a first idea of how the sounds are interacting with the car noises, with the aerodynamics noises, etc., etc. At the same time, while we work, we also they do a hi-fi recording with good material, and also they record the performance, the telemetrics of the car. They put on an online storage. I download them. I listen in cycles of 2 hours, 2-3 hours, and then I send them back stuff. So we iterate this whole scheme, which is extremely interesting, useful. Everybody is much more connected to the project because everybody has more responsibility to listen and react. And of course, there is less travel, less planes, less pollution, et cetera, et cetera. And I stop here.
Okay, that was rather sudden. Okay, thank you very much, Andrea. You're faithful to your style. Okay, yeah. since we're a bit rushed, I would like to move on to the presentation of Bernhard Lang. And then I hope we will have some questions. We already have a couple of questions from the public, people looking at us on YouTube. So, Bernhard, so if you could proceed, please.
Yeah. I try to keep it short. I have modified my concept a little bit, and what I wanted to present is a project which happened during Corona, which was interrupted by Corona. I'm very grateful that Andrew already introduced this first project of ours back in 2010. And my main issue is that we should also devise some strategy of criticism, which concerns our situation, which concerns our definition of the subject and of the real. Thanks to Andrew for mentioning this reality principle, which is more or less a reference to Baudrillard, who has this thesis that in simulation, the real is being surpassed by the simulation, by the simulacrum. And what's happening now is that in 2010, there was this aesthetical ideal of making the issue of the simulacrum an aesthetic value, to make the issue of displacement, of the shift of presence, an aesthetic value. With the break in of the new catastrophic situation, this has changed radically because the usage of technology, which had an aesthetic value in itself back in the 2010s and previous, now became our first aid kit, so to say, to simulate bodily presence, to create a kind of crutch to carry on, which what we coined collaboration in various definitions in this session. And perhaps I give a short, what I did prepare is a short overview what happened concerning this collaborative project in the context of COVID, and which were the critical reviews resulting from that, and the possible consequences resulting from that. It was a project called Game 245, which is based on a Lacanian thesis, a Lacanian experiment. And the collaboration started actually in a first phase with Fabien Sevillac. This is a French artist which I've been collaborating for many years, and we did a piece called Le Puce, based on Gilles Deleuze, one of the last texts of Gilles Deleuze. She is well read in philosophy, and we had a lot of conversations in Paris, creating new projects and thinking out new ways of handling things. And this collaboration with Fabienne
naturally included all the tricks of Zoom and Skype previously. This is completely clear. It led to the idea to do this piece in a threefold collaboration between a composer, Hayuit Ensemble, which is based in Belgium, and IRCAM. And the collaboration with IRCAM is naturally a collaboration of scientific development. And in the context of research, of scientific research, the term collaboration becomes trivial. There are definitely situations in artistic work where collaboration is a trivial term, because any kind of scientific work, any kind of scientific research is done in teams. And so this collaboration between Robin Meyer and Sylvain Cardin took place in between IRCAM and Vienna. But suddenly, the catastrophe arrived. So what to do? We were not allowed to travel here. We were not allowed to travel there. And I think this whole concept of collaborating like we did previously, using the airplane in a completely amoral way, in a way which is ecologically simply mad. This more or less all belongs to the past. And I realized this when suddenly all the possibilities to travel from Paris to Vienna, or to travel from Brussels to Vienna became immensely tedious. But we tried. So due to the new technologies, I was able to attend rehearsals in IRCAM without my being present there. I was very happy to be able to do that. But this was for four singers, electric guitar, and live electronics. And I sat there in my room in Vienna, and I tried to attend the rehearsal in Paris like I used to do it. And on one hand, I was immensely grateful to be at least part of the show, but then I realized that one of my singers was really in a bad state. And something, if you work with singers, it's something you have to smell, to sense. You have to have this bodily presence, the nearness of the other person, to get the feel, so to say. You perceive a singer on many, many levels, not just by the voice. And it's a global perception, more or less. And I suddenly felt completely crippled because I could not touch her. I could not help her. I could not get into the thing. And the limits really slammed me into the face. I said, okay, I can just check the pitches and I can check the sounds, but that's the limit. So, but we kept on. The singers were not allowed to travel to Paris anymore. And we were in the middle of the preparation of our premiere in Leuven with Transit Festival. So what did we do? Thanks to Robin, who really looked for all the possible solutions he could get. We did sessions in Paris, creating parts of the tracks we were playing with, sent them to Brussels. They sang onto the track, sent them back to Paris, something you do now nearly each day. And we assembled the piece, a virtual version of the piece, finally in Paris. And this was a rough first draft. And then we finally made it to Ghent and to Brussels, to Leuven. And we managed to do the first performance amidst the shutdown. And this situation also influenced the whole setup, the possible setups of the piece, the spatial grouping of musicians. Perhaps I give you a clue of this. What you see here is the singers, and they are stand in the center of the audience, which is being displaced in around the singers, because they sang towards each other. It wasn't possible in a different way. And it was a trick to not to infect, to give a possible infection to the audience. And the audience was more or less displaced and limited to a very small group. And the singers there was meant to be movement in this piece. There was meant to be walking around of the singers, and it was completely reduced. Suddenly, it was just the focus on this quartet turned inwards, away from the audience, and singing with high concentration for 1 hour. So perhaps it's now a good time to give you a 2 minutes glimpse or 1 minute glimpse of the piece. And it was not possible to record it via video because the video guy wasn't allowed to walk around. So we just put a camera onto the mixing desk, and that's what you see now. I would ask Andrew to play the a short excerpt from the clip.
It's coming right away.
Thank you. Perhaps since we are short of time, I would just interrupt this here. Just to come to an end, I think the challenge is now to realize the shift in the aesthetic paradigm, that the aesthetic value of displacement, for example, which is a questioning of identity and of the artistic subject in itself, and the subject of the performer in itself, which was an issue in the piece Andrew presented at the beginning of the meeting, is to be questioned anew. We have to really to question how affects the whole media system we are using right now is affecting our way to think this displacement shift. I could not do this piece, this strike piece I did in 2010 now. It wouldn't make any sense anymore, because the proof is just right in front of us. Look at us, how we are communicating right now. This is, it has become something also trivial, more or less. And it's the same when the internet started. There was really is a special brand of internet art connecting two points in the world together. And it, everybody was very fascinated by that. And then one American scientist told me a story about dioramas. When the art form of diorama was first discovered at the turn of the century, it was thought to be the new way of representing visual art in the 20th century, and there were hundreds of dioramas popping up all over Europe. And we all know what happened to those dioramas. What's the history of those dioramas? So, for me, it's a real challenge which I experienced in this very project game 245. Is how to react and which consequences we can draw from the future. Because the state we described here is a little bit already in the past. These are things more or less gone, at least for a while.
Okay, thank you very much, Bernhard. So this brings us to the end of the presentations. I think that one thing that I can say right away is that through the various presentations, we have such a rich amount of information and perspectives and experiences and questions that are put on the table that would be impossible to deal with within the time that is left of this roundtable. I do have some specific questions, but I do have also a question from people who are listening to us via YouTube, and this is a question that is for Andrea Agostini, and the question is, what if any specific problems did you encounter during the new thing experience?
I think it's about the collective composition experience, but okay, it might extend to basically all the things. A lot of problems, actually, because it's it was really an exercise of renunciation to oneself's ego, in a way. So the problems were, the big problems were that we used to fight all the time, basically. So that was the big thing, which was also very productive in a way. And, you know, the friendship has not diminished since then. But it was difficult at the time. Then we had technical problems and how do I exchange the file and version conflicts and whatever, but they're all simple to manage. The very complicated thing was the fact that we were all used to work on our own and to be the only responsibles for our own ego. And that was a scenario in which this was not possible anymore.
Okay. And I also have one other question for you. Were there any specific tools used during the project that were specifically used because of their collaborative nature or their capacity to leverage the collaborative process?
Well, very trivially, I would say, first of all, Dropbox. So we didn't use any very specific and advanced thing. We had a lot of Skype meetings because it was the Skype era and not the Zoom era yet. So a lot of Skype and a lot of Dropbox to exchange things. And then especially between some of us who were more into this kind of things, a lot of Max programming.
Okay. But there was no sort of special technology that was used or created rather to accelerate the collaboration.
No, not really. We put at good use existing technologies, I'd say.
Okay, so my first question would be, do any of the participants in the roundtable have questions for each other based on what has been presented? Bernhard? Because
perhaps to Ute.
I knew it. Okay.
Yes. Ute, how would you see this from your experience? I have played for 30 years in collective improvisation units. And for me nowadays, the realization by Helmut Lachenmann that everything's political also refers to this experience from these improvisation units. Because on the long run, I realized that the principles of the society we are part of and which is surrounding us is also being mirrored in setups like this.
Well, what is the question now?
I ask you about your experience concerning this, if you handle collective units, since please.
Maybe in some ways, because we are already seeing like the third and fourth generation of those collective units, also in improvisation. So sometimes it seems that it has become sort of a adapted. Adapted strategy rather than an own experience. So I'm not sure that free improvisation or also free jazz in the fourth generation does have the same implementations as it had maybe 40, 50, 60 years ago.
Yes, it's something different. I thought more about the social structures emerging in an improvisation unit, because as improvisation units are being considered in the science of dynamical systems as a paradigm of emergence, of emerging structures. And this does concern the division of roles, responsibilities, and all this, and the definition of authorship, and which you mentioned, and the definition of leadership, for example, or whatever. Because if you have collaboration, when I reflected in preparation for this meeting, I thought, okay, we are talking egalitarian collaboration or a collaboration which divides roles and competencies and
a question which
represents a hierarchy of sorts.
Yeah. It's a question which type of improvisation we're talking. When we're talking, for example, of conducted improvisation, there's definitely one guiding figure leading through the whole thing. Or if we talk of improvisation that is not totally free and on scratch and on spot, but going along with some predeterminations or concepts or modules to be used, etc., it has a different pattern and a different implication again. So it's really a question which type or which mingling types of improvisation we are talking.
What I meant was the emergence of structures, not the preordained structures. Not the structures which were given in the setup of the improvisation. Okay, you are absolutely right. If I make an improvisation with, like Stockhausen did, this is something else if you go to Brotzmann, to a Brotzmann improvisation. But what this emergence of political definitions of hierarchies and all this, because for me it was very interesting if I look over 30 years. For example, a very interesting point in collaborations is for me are quarrels. The issue of quarrels and conflicts, which I can tell you the history of bands is the history of quarrels, basically.
And so you mean I was drawing a much, much too modest picture of improvisation, or you want to counter...
You can ask any musician doing this. It's really an issue, and how to handle this, for example, how to handle quarrels. Perhaps Andrea can give us perhaps an insight into that. If you have a collective of composers, are there any quarrels?
Yeah, all the time. Of Of course.
Yeah, I believe you.
Okay, thank you very much, Ute and Bernhard, for this exchange. That was very interesting. We have to quit in about 1 minute, but I have just one question for also Andrea Agostini. One thing I picked up on what he mentioned was this, the question of in the group, okay, there are similar competences, but in the end, there are a certain number of specialties. So the specialties are applied to realize such and such a piece. And so I'm going to be really old fashioned for about 5 minutes, for 2 seconds here. If we go back to the Renaissance workshops where you had the masters and the assistants and so on and so forth, you had the assistants were there because they had specific competences. They knew how to do landscapes, they knew how to do curtains, they knew how to do, you know, whatever, faces and so on and so forth. And so maybe again the real issue with collaboration is the ability to put together these various competences. But then there comes the question of vision. Who has the vision of the work that is being done? And is vision something that can be shared, or simply can it be shared, or can it not be shared completely simply because of the way our brain works?
Okay, that's a very good question, and I don't have a definite answer. But I can just talk about my personal experience in this case. And in this case, I think I have no idea whether the overall vision was shared, but for sure I can say the overall vision was collective in a way. Then possibly every one of us had a different angle and a different point of view on that. But the fact itself that for establishing the overall structure of the work, we decided to work in a rather improvisational way and through a series of brainstormings. I think that I can say, you know, when you were talking about the apprenticeship in the Renaissance atelier, I was about to think, okay, then everybody of us was the assistant, or probably everyone's was some master's assistant, and everyone was taking turn into being the master and someone else's apprentice.
Okay. And I have another quick question for you, and then we will have to end here because there's another session coming up. You mentioned the fact that when working together, one of the advantages was to take advantage of each other's competences and learn something from the others, okay? So,
yes.
So would it be fair to say that maybe this collaborative experience of coming together like that is something where you will disengage for a while and then you will come back together? And so it will be a kind of an oscillatory process between individuality and collectivity, so to speak. Is that?
Yes, this is definitely the case.
Okay. Yes. Well, that was a quick and short answer. Thank you very much. Thanks for all of you. And so I'm sorry that we didn't have the time to really go into all the rich material questions, perspectives, points of view, experiences that were raised during the roundtable. But I'm sure that there will be other possibilities in the future for doing this, either face-to-face or Zoom or some panache of that. Okay, so thank you very much to all. And so that's the end of this roundtable. And for those who are online, thank you very much for your attention. And so we will now move on to the next session of the afternoon. Thank you very much.
Thank you, bye-bye.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye. Bye.